I know that we've been blessed by the Strength Builder series over these last 3 months. And I know that today, as we come to the end of the Strength Builder series, I want to start with something that will truly, truly encourage you. But before I do that, I want to bring you back to a moment in my life, 39 years ago, when I got married. How many of you remember your wedding day? But I remember my wedding day for all the wrong reasons, because it was the one day when everything went wrong. 39 years ago, Nancy and I were married in this beautiful church at Oxford called St. Ebb's Church. A week before the wedding, I lost my contact lenses. And I rang my opticians in London and I said, "Can I have a new pair of lenses, please?" They said, "Sure, sir. It will take you 2 weeks." I said, "I'm getting married next week." They said, "I'm sorry, sir. You'll have to get married a little bit blurred or blind." And Nancy took her glasses off just to look beautiful for the photographs. And so she couldn't see very well either. So both of us got married in a blur. It was a case of the blind marrying the blind. We tied the knot more by faith rather than by sight. And on the morning of the wedding, my car wouldn't start. Just half an hour before my car was about to take me to church, it wouldn't start. I had a flat battery. And my best man, who was then a medical student, but today is a professor of medicine in the UK, he was a medic. He was absolutely aghast at that. He ran into the hostel where we were overnighting, knocked on every door, got everybody out, in the morning, and people walking on their pajamas, really sleepy. And they said, "My friend, he's all dressed up. He's got a wedding, but right now he can't get there." So everybody gave the car a push. And eventually, that's how I got to the church on time. Now, people often ask me, "How were you married?" I said, actually, I didn't have very much choice. I was physically pushed into the arms of my wife, and that's the truth. And on the wedding morning, things went wrong again. Nancy and I, we were pretty cavalier and gung-ho. We thought we'd seen so many weddings before, and therefore we didn't have a rehearsal. We quite sure we knew what to do. Guys, if you're getting married anytime soon, have a rehearsal. Okay, please have a rehearsal. We didn't have any rehearsals at all. So we came to the point where the minister said to me, "And Philip, you may now kiss your beautiful bride." I thought to myself, I know what to do. So I lifted up her veil, and I planted a firm kiss on her lips. And then after that, I thought, "What do you do now? I've forgotten." So I pulled the veil down again. And everybody was laughing and rolling in the aisles. It was like a Mr. Bean wedding, And and it was, from that moment, it was a comedy. And the worst was to come. When we came to the point of cutting the cake, it was another comedy show. Pastor Nancy and I, we didn't have a lot of money then, and so we got married on a grand, extravagant budget of £150. That's our budget for the wedding. So any and everybody who could help us in the wedding for free, we gladly accepted. And there was somebody who was a friend who offered to make us a wedding cake for free. And we said, gladly. But she never told us she had never made a wedding cake before. So when it came to the point where we had to cut the wedding cake, we both jointly hoisted up the knife and we sliced into the cake, but it wouldn't cut. Then we started applying a lot more pressure. It still wouldn't cut. Then we started sawing through the cake. It still wouldn't cut. Then we realized she had made the icing of the wedding cake as thick and as hard as concrete slabs. And by which time they remove all the tiered layers of the cake for us to try to hack through the wedding cake. It still wouldn't hack through. And finally, both of us hoisted up the knife jointly like a samurai sword. And we went high and we chopped the cake. And that's how we started our marriage. It was a bad start. But here, 39 years later, we're still happily married. We are still best of friends. She's my best friend, and we're continuing well. A bad start has a good continuation, and hopefully a good ending. Can somebody say amen? And that is the topic of the final Strength Builder series today. Bad start doesn't mean bad ending. Somebody say an amen to that. A bad start doesn't mean a bad ending. I don't know what you're going through right now. You may be in the middle stage of your life, or young stage of your life, or later stage of life, but you've got to start somewhere. You may be going through a start of a marriage, a start of a family, a start of a workplace, a start of a relationship, a start of a business, and things are going really rocky. Things are going really bad. I want to say this to you. God wants you to know, a bad start doesn't necessarily mean a bad ending. God wants you to know that His will for you, wherever you are in your start, however bad it is right now, He wants you to have a good ending. Can somebody say amen? And you know, I want to draw from a passage in the scriptures, from a prayer actually, that is one of the most powerful prayers and one of the shortest prayers ever uttered by a man and the most obscure man in the history of Israel. The name of that man was Jabez. And we find his prayer listed for us in 1 Chronicles chapter 4 in two verses, verses 9 and 10. And I want to ask you to read with me right now the prayer of Jabez. 1 Chronicles 4, verses 9 to 10. Now Jabez was more honorable than his brothers, and his mother called his name Jabez, because I bore him in pain. And Jabez called on the God of Israel, saying, "Oh, that you would bless me indeed and enlarge my territory, and that your hand would be with me, and that you would keep me from evil, that I may not cause pain." So God granted him what he requested. That's an amazing prayer. Just two verses. And yet, in all this, people come back again and again to one of these most powerful prayers ever uttered in the whole Bible. And why is that so? Well, let me take you through as to why this is so. Firstly, let's ask, who was Jabez and what did his name mean? You know, Jabez was from the tribe of Judah. You read it in the beginning of chapter 4. If you read 1 Chronicles, you will find that the first 9 chapters of Chronicles is all about genealogy. So-and-so is the son of so-and-so, and that so-and-so is the son of so-and-so, and so on and so on and so forth. It is an interminable, boring list of genealogies, name after name after name of nameless, unknown personages, until you come to 1 Chronicles chapter 4, verses 9 to 10, and suddenly you hit on a name called Jabez. And you're not told very much about it. So that name remains obscure. We don't know very much about this guy. But this guy, unlike all the other guys that's named in the genealogies, 9 chapters of genealogies in 1 Chronicles, and all this variety of nameless names or nameless faces that you read about, this name is not known for royalty or royal status. It's not known for wealth. It's not known for the fact that he built buildings and fortresses and palaces. It's not known for the fact that he won wars or he was a great general. It's known only for one thing, for the prayer that he prayed. That's amazing. 9 chapters worth of names, and one name sticks out like a shining star. And you only know the name of Jabez today because of the prayer that he prayed. But what does his name mean? What do we know about this guy? His name was Jabez. What did it mean? Well, he caused so much pain in his childbirth that his mother called him Pain. It's amazing. The mother suffered such a painful childbirth that she called him Pain. What a name for a mother to give a child. I mean, every mother should know that they will have pain in childbirth. But you know, why did the mother call him Pain? It's like, you know what? A mother calling a child after he is born, Sakit Perut. That's not a nice name. It's like a mother calling a child, Tou Tong. What a name. Fancy going to school, everybody call you Tou Tong, Tou Tong. Can you imagine? Just imagine, like in English language, somebody calling their child Pain in the neck, or Pain in some part of the anatomy. I mean, what a name to have on your birth certificate. What's your name? Pain in the neck. That's incredible. That's a terrible, terrible name. In some cases, the name is so bad that, you know, it's better to have, you know, I'm not making fun of any Chinese names, but just in case you had a name like that, if you had a name like Angao or Achi or even Amiao, it is better than the name Da Tou Tong. You know what I mean? It's much better than that sort of name. He had that name, Pain. Not that the name Jabez in Hebrew means pain. It sounds like the Hebrew word for pain. Now, you may ask, what's in the name? So what, love? What's in the name? In Hebrew genealogy, everything. Everything's in the name. Well, Proverbs 22 verse 1 tells us, a good name is to be chosen above great riches. Favor is better than silver or gold. That means a good name is like favor. It's even better than silver or gold. Because when a Hebrew child is named, when they proclaim his name, they are proclaiming his destiny, their hopes on that child and his future or her future. That's what it means. There's favor in the name. So when God called Abram, when Abram was called Abram, showed him the stars in the sky and promised to make him a father of a great nation, God said to Abram, your name shall be called Abraham. It's in a name. Just like when the man wrestled with Jacob at the brook Jabbok, and because Jacob prevailed, the man who was the angel of God said to Jacob, Jacob, from this day, your name will no longer be called Jacob, the supplanter, the deceiver, the cheater. Your name will be called Israel, because you have struggled with God and man and you have won. So a good name is a blessing. A bad name, therefore, scripturally, you read it right through scriptures, often brings curses. What does it mean for us today? Now, some of us may come from backgrounds, and God is saying this to us as much as to me. Some of us may come from backgrounds where, you know, there is the curse upon our own family name. You may have lived in communities and villages or in a town where that family, it's known, you know, that family, they're always gamblers. They're always alcoholics. Generation after generation are gamblers and alcoholics. There's unfaithfulness, immorality in the family, always broken marriages. There's mistresses and promiscuity in the family. There's oppression or domestic violence or abuse in the family. They're always in debt. There's a family curse upon that name. And some of us may recognize this. Even in our own family tree, there is an association. When we are told this again and again by our ancestors, for our grandmothers or our parents or whatever, or friends around us who know about our family history, we suddenly realize, actually, we are an accident waiting to happen. Doesn't matter what we do. Eventually, somebody in the family is going to die early. Somebody is going to get a terrible tragedy or an accident or devastating illness. A name can be a family curse. A name can be a social cloud. Social studies have shown that if you have a bad name, often it reduces your self-confidence. In school, can you imagine on the playground, people call you sakit perut? It just reduces the self-confidence, your self-image. Eventually, names that are not nice will just hinder people from fulfilling their destinies and their life accomplishments. And where they marry, or in the kind of college, university they go to, it is often a social cloud. And so when you're walking with a name that says pain, you're a pain. Hey, pain, come here. Pain in the neck, come here. It is a social cloud. It's a very hard name to live under. But yet, the power of the prayer of Jabez for us, my friends, and for every one of us, whether young or old as you're listening today, is God can break through the curses that come from whatever has happened to you before, whether it's your fault or not your fault, and make you a winner. Somebody say amen to that. Now, if you know what social cloud is, I wonder if you ever watched this movie called Meet the Parents. Have you ever watched this movie? It's a 2004 movie, or old movie that came out with Robert De Niro and Ben Stiller. Ben Stiller acts as the wonderful male nurse who woos a beautiful girl who actually belongs to a very well-established middle-class family. The problem with Ben Stiller, the maleness, this good maleness, is that he carried a name that was terrible. Actually, I'll just tell you his name, and I'll explain why I'm telling you his name. His name was actually called Greg Foker. Greg Foker. Now, you might think, well, Pastor, is that a terrible? No. Actually, the surname, that surname is a legit surname in the United States. It comes from Dutch ancestry. That's why you have our Foker friendship planes. You know what I mean? So his name was He was Greg Fokker. And that name, when he was introduced to the family, just tripped up the whole family. They were in absolute stitches. They were laughing at him all the time. All the time. And as you go through the movie, you're laughing and rolling in your seat. But it's a very painful movie. You're very aware that the only reason why people are casting aspersions on this guy and disparaging him is because of his name. Okay, for a spoiler, eventually he gets his girl and marries her. Okay, so that if you haven't watched the movie and you don't want to watch it, I'll tell you the ending now. It was the same for Jabez. He had a pretty bad start. How do we know he had a bad start besides his name? Because for a woman, for a mother to name the child Pain, that child must have been causing her lots of pain through the whole pregnancy. Lots of early morning sickness, you know, loss of appetite, always grouchy because, you know, making her tired, always kicking her tummy, rolling round and round so that she gets sleepless nights. And so I can't take this child anymore. And finally he comes, and when he comes, he calls her Pain. So can you imagine? The mother said, well, you know, I don't know. She doesn't even like the child. Maybe he was rejected. He was badly named. That's why he had a bad start. He was rejected, badly named. He was a constant reminder of what he caused his mum. And you know, the verse need not mention it. The verse mentioned that he had brothers. So he was probably an underdog amongst his brothers. Can you imagine the rest of the family, all his brothers having good names, but he having a terrible name? He had to climb another mountain to get on par with his brothers. He had a pretty bad start. But here's the point now. That's the background to Jabez. But there are five amazing things Jabez prayed to break the curse over his life. And this prayer is so powerful that if we learn to pray the prayer of Jabez for our life, for the rest of our lives, it will enable God to break through in our lives again and again and again. But I will tell you how you must use the prayer of Jabez. Not just a mantra that you chant, but how you can use it. And it can be a powerful weapon to break through every curse in your life. Here's the first of the five things. Firstly, Jabez called upon God. Everybody say, called upon God. That's great. Now, Jabez was more honorable than his brothers. And Jabez called on the God of Israel. Notice two things in this verse. He was more honorable than his brothers. I told you he had brothers. And then he called on the God of Israel. Now, the word honorable here, it's not what it seems. When we say somebody is honorable, we think that he does noble acts like a gentleman would do. You know, honorable people who are gentlemanly in conduct open the doors for their girlfriends and their wives for a woman. Let the ladies go first. They're well polished in their etiquette at mealtimes. They're very equitable in a conversation. They're quite polished in their manners. They dress well. That's a gentlemanly honorability. That's how we associate with the word honorable. You know, that's how, but that's not what it means. The word honorable here in the Hebrew actually is derived from the Hebrew word kabod. The Hebrew word kabod is the word weight, W-E-I-G-H-T. And it is used of God's holiness. When the holiness of God comes into Solomon's temple, the kabod, the weight of God's splendor comes in. So when we talk about Jabez being an honorable man, it means this. He was distinguished from his brothers who were not honorable. He separated himself from his brothers in a way so that he would gather and grow more of the glory, of the weight of God's glory upon his life. That's what honorable means here. You know, he had all his brothers and they're probably disparaging him because of his name. But it's what Jabez did. He sought for the glory of God. Because the word honorable, the kabod, actually also means separating yourself because of holiness. God's holiness means separating yourself. He separated himself from his brothers so that the weight of God's glory might fall on him more and more. That's the first secret about this guy, Jabez. He was honorable in the kabod sense. Secondly, he called upon God. Some translations translate, he cried out to God. And the way the word called upon God is not like, oh God, it's not a reactive word. Where you call upon God and shout out to God in anger and exasperation because good things that you prayed for haven't happened. God, why are you like that? Reactive, knee-jerk, called upon God, God. No. The word called upon God is that he cried out to God. And that word carries an intimate relationship with God. Just like Jesus cried out to God on the cross to his Father, Elohi, Elohi, lama sabachthani. He had a relationship with his Father. It was not a reactive, exasperated cry of anger or demand. He called upon God. He cried out to God, which means he prayed aloud in his heart to God in an intimate way. He had already cultivated intimacy with God because he separated himself for the glory of God to come upon him. Honor, he was an honorable man. And now because he knew God intimately, one-on-one in relationship, he cried out to God from his heart. That's what the word means. He called upon God. And what did he call? What did he cry out? He said these words. You read it. Oh, that you would bless me indeed and enlarge my territory. Your hand would be with me and that you would keep me from evil, that I may not cause pain. When you read this, many people reading Jabez's prayer thinks that it's one of the most selfish prayers around. Because Jabez was praying a me prayer. Oh, that you would bless me. Enlarge my territory, that your hand would be with me, that you would keep me from evil. No, my friends, it's not a me prayer. It's not a self-centered, self-preserving prayer. When you read it, you will know that the prayer is not about me, but the prayer he prayed was you, me. It was a you, me prayer. It is. Oh, that you would bless me and enlarge my territory. Your hands would be with me. You would keep me from evil. That's it. It was a God-centered, God-surrendered prayer. Totally God-centered. You, me. And why can he pray a prayer like that? Because he had intimacy with God. He was honorable. The glory of God was on him. Therefore, he could cry out to God, just like Jesus did on the cross. So the first step to breaking curses in our lives is to live in intimacy with God and to be so filled with his glory that we can call upon him anytime because we know him. We are walking in intimacy with him. His glory is upon us all the time. He's never far. We know him as a father, so we call to him. You know, when my children were very young, sometimes they were in danger, you know, because somebody was trying to bully them, or somebody was trying to, take them away or whatever. And, you know, they were facing some dangers. You know, suddenly one of my child will cry out, Daddy! I know that cry. It may be exasperated. It might be a shout, but I know it's a danger. And the reason why this child can shout like that is because I have a relationship with the child. It's the same when you have intimacy with God like that. You can shout, Father! And you can shout like that because you have a relationship. So when we live in intimacy with God and filled with his glory, then we can call upon him. That's the first thing Jabez did to break the curse. People say to me, but Pastor, you're asking me to pray this prayer. Call upon God. You know, but does God hear my prayer? I've been doing that for years. God hasn't heard my prayer. My situation hasn't changed. You know, my family is still like that. Hasn't changed. Let me tell you about Jabez so that you understand. Many people, when they study the prayer of Jabez, they think Jabez is just a kind of a mantra, a good luck charm. You know, just wear it on your chest or just recite it whenever. No. If you read the context of the prayer of Jabez, you will find this. Jabez prayed this prayer many, many times. He didn't just pray the prayer once. He prayed it many times. Many, 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 many times. In fact, it was his lifestyle. That's what he prayed all the time. Oh God, that you would bless me, that you will enlarge my territory. Lord, that your hand would be upon me, that you will keep me from evil, that I may not cause pain. Oh Lord, that... How do I know that? Because when the chronicler wrote about Jabez, that's the only thing about Jabez he remembers. That's the only thing that signifies, that makes Jabez stand out of all the other names when the chronicler wrote about Jabez. What does it tell you? That was his prayer. He had prayed it all his life. Everybody knew he prayed that prayer. He sometimes prayed it quietly, sometimes prayed it loudly, but everybody knew it was his lifestyle. And he prayed it through many, many, many years of his life. So you say to me, Pastor, I've been praying this prayer last 2 years. I've not heard any reply. I would say this to you. Jabez prayed it as a lifestyle, his whole life. Many years. I don't know how many years. Bible doesn't tell me. But one thing I know, at the end of the two verses of description about Jabez, the Bible tells us these words. And God granted him what he requested. God granted it to him. So this first thing I want to say about the prayer of Jabez, you enter in intimacy with God, His glory is upon you. You pray and you cry out to God. Not just once or twice. It's your lifestyle. It's your life prayer for the rest of your life and mine. Let's pray this prayer, Skyline. Let's pray this prayer for our family. Let's pray this prayer for our lives. Let's pray this prayer for our children, for our marriage. Let's pray this prayer. Not once, but again and again. And the second thing prayer Jabez did, what? He called to God to bless him. Everybody say, bless. How many of you want God to bless you? Can you raise up your hand? Many people in this auditorium. I see many people also online. By faith, you've raised up your hand. And Jabez called on the God of Israel saying, oh, that you would bless me. What does word blessing mean? The word blessing mean is a download of supernatural favor upon your lives. That God doing something for your life that you can never do for yourself. Out of His infinite goodness and His infinite grace and His mercy, He downloads it upon you because He's a good God. He downloads it, but you can never do this upon yourself. And Jabez didn't say, God, bless me because, bless me with a penthouse, please, or Swiss, or holiday villa, or, a private jet, or, a $10 million. He didn't name any of these things. He said to God, just bless me. Whatever way you want to bless, just bless me. Any way you like, however, whenever, whichever, just bless me. He left what form the blessing would take, when it would come, all in God's hand. That's why he was so God-centered. He was so God-centered. He left it entirely in God's hand. He was actually like giving God a blank check. Pay Jabez. Lord, whatever you want to put down, whatever the blessing I receive. How many of you want to receive whatever blessings God gives you? Can I see your hands? Wave it in the air. Wave it. You online, wave it in the air. That's the best way to pray, my friends. Not just like, I want this. I want best blessing, your blessing or whatever. I receive it. That's the best way to pray. Why? Because God knows the big end from the beginning. He knows what's the best time. He knows what's the best way and what you best need. Only God's blessings can reverse our curses. You see, why? Because only His blessings can reverse our curses. Galatians 3:13, Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law, having become a curse for us, as it is written, cursed is everyone who hangs on a tree, so that the blessings of Abraham might come to us, the Gentiles. The blessings of God breaks the curses over your life. So when you know this, your prayer of Jabez is God bless me, whichever way you like. Just break the curse over my life. Can somebody say an amen to that? And that's what God wants you to have. It's just like a man who tipped over a cliff at night, couldn't see, and he hung on a branch on a cliff, and he said, God, help me. And a voice from heaven said, let go of the branch, my son. He thought about it. Then he looked up and said, is anyone else up there? And the voice comes down and say again, let go of the branch, my son. But he wouldn't let go. He just held onto the branch for hours on end, changed hands because he was absolutely exhausted. The winds came, the rains came, the hail came. He was pelted with rain. He was freezing. He suffered through the night. He was absolutely exhausted, nearly died. Next morning as the sun rose at dawn, he looked down and there he was, just 4 feet above some sand, sandy beach. He should have let go. Leave the blessings to God. Because that's what God wants. Here's the third thing that Jabez did. He prayed to God, God, enlarge my territory. Verse 10, oh, that you would bless me indeed and enlarge my territory. Expand my borders. Now, I don't mean in a physical sense. I know some of you, during lockdown, you have really expanded your physical borders and enlarge your territory. I don't mean that in terms of weight gain. When Jabez prayed, enlarge my territory, or in some versions it says, expand my borders, it means this. It means that expansion of your spiritual and personal self. It expansion of yourself. You become a bigger person of faith. You have become a bigger person of faith. of influence, a bigger mindset than ever. You have grown in these ways. You have become bigger in your heart today than you were many years ago. You have grown. You've grown bigger in your heart to forgive those who've offended you, who sabotage you, to forgive your enemies and to move on from there. You've developed a bigger heart because you've received from God His glory and His intimacy. You do not let the past hold you back anymore. You have the capacity to overcome mountains and obstacles and barriers that you are facing. In the past, you'd be terrified of them. Now, because your expansion of your borders, enlarging your territory, you step over them. You have the capacity to overcome. And when you have that capacity to overcome, you know what? As you do so, you have the wisdom and the influence to grow. You've grown in wisdom. You've grown in influence. In your life, you can influence lives, you can influence your office, you can influence society, you can influence your family. And God has increased and grown your finances so that you now know what to use your finances for kingdom generosity. Last time it was just for me, for my family, now you know how to use it for kingdom generosity. You've expanded your borders. Expand my borders means you have grown larger today because your God is big. And has become bigger. Somebody said amen to that. But you know, expand your borders, you know, means also enlarging our minds. In the 1870s, Bishop Milton Wright was speaking at the United Brethren Church Conference in the United States. Somebody in the conference stood up and said, "One day man will fly." And Bishop Milton Wright stood up and said, "That's rubbish. Man was not created to fly. Angels fly, birds fly. But men don't fly." That was his view. He was going to be proven wrong 40 years later when his two sons, Orville and Wilbur Wright, became the first men to fly. They were the ones who took the first man flight on the sands of Kitty Hawk in North Carolina. And Milton Wright, Bishop Milton Wright, had to eat his words, expand and change his mind completely. And if you lived in the 1907, when the first flight took place, you cannot imagine that today an A380 Airbus weighing 1.2 million pounds could take off effortlessly with a full capacity load. You cannot imagine that can take place because of the discovery of the law of aviation and flight that would give the airplane a lift and overcome that of gravity. You have to enlarge your mind. When you say enlarge my capacity, it means enlarging my vision for myself, for my faith, for what you can do through my life, for the largeness of my heart to forgive those who have hurt me and offended me and overcome obstacles on the way and fulfill my vision and destiny. Somebody say an amen. Can somebody say an amen? Expand my borders also means multiply my life, because the word expand means increase. Increase the numbers of my life. How can you increase the numbers of your life? Here's how you increase: by discipleship and mentoring. Hey guys, if you are living just for yourself, for your 20 cents worth of encouragement from a Sunday service, or you know, reading things for yourself, coming to church for yourself, coming to connect groups for yourself, just for yourself, for your 20 cents worth of encouragement, you are not living Jabez. You're not living the prayer of Jabez. You are not living what Jabez was living for. You are not living like that. Because the prayer of Jabez was, expand my borders, Lord, multiply my life. This is what Jabez did. He sowed his life in discipleship and mentoring so that he could multiply his life. What kind of lives do you want to multiply? Friends, let me tell you what kind of lives you should be multiplying. The Jabez kind of life. Can somebody say an amen? The Jabez kind of life. You should be multiplying that kind of life. And that's why in the coming year, in Skyline, for every Skyliner who is ready to be a mentor and a discipler, we're going to give you the mandate to begin to sow into somebody's life in mentoring one or two or even three people, to mentor them so that in the next 2 years, you will be sowing into life to multiply your lives. That is why this is a Jabez church. This is a Jabez praying church, and we are a Jabez people. Somebody say amen to that. Amen. Fourthly, Jabez prayed, "Your hand would be with me." What is God's hand? God's hand is a prayer of empowerment. God's hand is empowerment. So this is a prayer of empowerment. He said, "God, empower me." The hand of God signifies His approval and power. What does God's hand does? If you read the Bible, you see whenever God's hand is used, it means this hand has the power to cast the enemy, to slay the enemy, to push back the enemy, to remove the forces of darkness and the oppression. It is a hand to protect you. It is a hand to comfort you. It is a hand to guide you. The hand to strengthen you. It's the hand to heal you. That's the hand of God. It's the hand of approval and power. Isaiah 59 verse 1 says, "Behold, the Lord's hand is not short that he cannot save." Acts 11 verse 22-21 says, "And the hand of the Lord was with them, and a great number who believed turned to the Lord." If you read these two verses, you know the Lord's hand is not too short. It cannot save. The Lord's hand is powerful. "And the hand of the Lord was with them, and great numbers turned to the Lord." The Lord's hand is gracious. He does blessings. He can increase your supply. The hand of God is a sign of God's approval, God's comfort, God's protection, God's power over your lives. So when Jabez said, "God, empower my life." How many of you want God to empower your life? Lift up your hands, wave it in the air right now in the auditorium and in on the online. You wave it because you want God's power in your life. Because the forces of darkness are trying to put a curse on you to stop you from fulfilling God's destiny in your life. And what would it need for us to get God's approval and His power to enlarge our tent and our territory? The blood of Jesus. You see, it's been done for us. Jesus' blood takes away God's wrath from our sins. That's why He is our Father. That's why we can have intimacy with Him. Somebody say amen. That's why we can come near to Him. That's why the glory of God, the presence of God can live in us. Make room, guys, to come intimate with Him. Because the blood of Jesus. What can take away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can cleanse me from within? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that washes white as snow. No other name I know. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. And because we can get into God's power and approval, we can get into breaking curses over our life. Your hand is mainly means that God will care for you. God's healing and miracles will come upon you. There's guidance and protection over your lives. There's turnarounds in your life. There's a breaking of curses over your life. Let me share with you something in my own family. You know, my family were second generation nominal Anglicans. And they were nominal Christians. But somewhere in my father's generation, they opened themselves to the influence of geomancy. Or feng shui. And somehow the feng shui master came and said something about the burial sites of my ancestors. And they began to dabble in that. And there was a curse that came as a result that if you don't do all these things, you see, you put you open yourselves to the enemy, curses come in if you don't obey the enemy. You don't do these all these things, eventually curses will come into the family. And then some of the brothers, my father is one of six brothers and sisters. Some of the family members of the siblings will die early. And true enough, two of my uncles died early. And it was a very frightening time for the family. I was a little kid, I didn't know what was going on. But then when I grew and became a Christian and I knew the Lord, and I came back to visit my family from overseas, and I was growing in faith in my Lord, I said, "Dad, these things are wrong. You should not have any part in them." And eventually, as I grew, I began to have more influence in the family. I began to get the family and just broke the powers of darkness over them by the blood of Jesus. Oh, that your hand would be upon my family, upon me, upon my generation, the generation above. Oh, Lord, we ask forgiveness for all this. And that curse, I believe, was broken. Because after that, the scourge stopped. And of the six siblings, my father is the oldest. He's the eldest of the siblings. He was the last one to pass away. His scourge stopped because of the blood of Jesus. What can empower you today? You pray the prayer of Jabez. The power is not in the prayer of Jabez alone. It is founded on the blood of Jesus. Somebody say an amen to that. And finally, this is what Jabez did. He prayed, "Lord, you would keep me from evil, that I may not cause pain." That's a strange thing to pray. Why? Why is it such a strange thing to pray? It's because of this. If you read the prayer of Jabez, everything is growing greater and greater. Everything is on ascendancy to greatness. Oh, Lord, that you would bless me, that you would enlarge my tent, that your hand of approval and power and greatness may be upon me. It's going higher and higher and higher. You'd expect him to actually finish off the prayer and say, yours is the power and the glory forever and ever. You expect that. No. He suddenly finishes off the prayer and lands on the earth, planet earth, with a big bump. Lord, keep me from evil, that I may not cause pain. Why did he pray the prayer like Jesus? Yours is the kingdom, power, and the glory. Because Jesus is the Son of God. His is truly the kingdom and the power and the glory. He can pray that prayer and take us with him because he is the King of glory. And of his kingdom there shall be no end. Somebody say amen. He is. But Jabez, he's an ordinary man just like you and me. He was praying for success, for after success, after success. And when it got so high, he suddenly finished his prayer with these words. Lord, you keep me from evil, that it may not cause pain. Why is that? Because Jabez knew the dangers of success. You see, if you pray the prayer of just Jabez, and it's your lifestyle, and it's a living prayer, and it's a constant prayer, God will bless you. If you live according to the prayer of Jabez and pray the prayer of Jabez and it's founded on the blood of Jesus, God will bless you. But don't use it as a one-verse mantra. You know what? I just pray it whenever I'm in trouble. Pray it as a lifestyle. God will bless you because God granted him what he requested. We don't know from the verses how successful Jabez was. We don't know how wealthy he was. We don't know how high in society he became. He rose up. His name was Pain, you remember? Pain in the neck, sakit perut, whatever. Now he's risen so high and stuff. We don't know. We know that he must have succeeded because God granted him his request. He must have risen very high. But why now does he pray this prayer? That you keep me from evil, that I may not cause pain. Because of the dangers of success, my friends. The dangers of success. This is a very powerful prayer. It's one of the best prayers and the shortest prayers you can ever pray in the Bible. Because it's authentic, it's real, it punches, and it has no grandiose delusions about yourself. He knew the dangers of success. You see, the world will always celebrate success. The world will tell you if you're successful. Oh, well done. Success breeds success. Let's have more success. So let's have more. Enjoy success. Success, people, enjoy success more and more. Be more successful. The world says success breeds success. The Bible tells us, success breeds dangers. Dangers. And Jabez knew. That's why I know Jabez finished well. If you want to finish well in your life, you pray the prayer of Jabez because that's how he finished. He knew the dangers of success. He prayed this prayer so that he would finish well. Because he knew success breeds danger. What dangers do success bring? Pride, wealth, arrogance, entitlement. You see it even some Christian ministers, there's a great sense of entitlement because you've got a big church, you know, they expect the red carpet and special treatment. They expect this, they expect that. They expect people to kowtow to them. You see some of our politicians and some of our ministers, they expect that. But we did come temptations and then we take shortcuts because we think we're above the rules. Somehow the rules don't apply to us because everybody is saying to us, Lord, well done, well done. We become celebrity figures in ourselves. And you just have to look at the litany of fallen leaders recently in Christendom, and you would know success breeds dangers. And that's why this is such a fantastic prayer. Because it's 100% God-centered. It's 100% God-surrendered. And it's 100% God-granted. God granted him. That's why if we pray like this, God will grant it to us. And it's a fantastic way he ended. He said, keep me from evil, that I may not cause pain. You know what's the biggest pain? Many people who have fallen into immorality, unfaithfulness, and so on in ministry, what's the biggest pain in their lives? The pain and the hurts they cause to their family. When they look at their family, they start crying. Right now, you may not follow cricket. I follow cricket. The Australian cricket captain has just been found sexting. And the Ashes series is just 3 weeks away. And he's had to resign. And as he shares, you know, who gets hurt? His whole family. He's crying and he's crying. Keep me from evil. The Lord is saying to each and every one of us, when you pray this prayer, that I may not cause pain and shame and tragedy to my family, to my loved ones. to the church of God, to the name of Christ, and ultimately to my own legacy. Now you know why the prayer of Jabez covers everything. Everything. It's the shortest, most powerful prayer ever prayed in the Bible, in terms of its length, I'm talking about. Just in terms of its length, what goes in? By the most obscure person in the whole history of Israel. And I believe God left it for us so that we may learn to pray the prayer of Jabez for our lives. And this church may learn to pray the prayer of Jabez for its life. Because the greatest pain that will be ever inflict will be on the people firstly that we love, the church that we love, the name of Christ, and finally on our own legacy. Just think about it. Everything you've done for 30, 40 years, and there are Christian ministers like that today, also have gone to be with the Lord, but 30, 40, 50 years, and then when you stand at the end, all that is shambles. How much pain does it cause your life? Jabez knew. He knew. He knew his heart. He knew his God. And he said, God, keep me from evil, that I may not cause pain. And that's why, my friends, if you get a chance to pray this prayer, you must know that God wants you to finish well. Because a bad start doesn't mean a bad ending. If you want to have a great ending and to finish well with God, wherever you are right now, in this auditorium or online, I want to invite you to stand up on your feet right now, because I want to pray for you wherever you are right now. Thank you, Lord. I want today to just lead you in a very simple prayer of Jabez. I want you to articulate it loud with your heart and cry to God. Don't articulate it with a mantra. If you don't believe in the prayer of Jabez and its power, I've expounded it to you today. If you really don't believe it, it doesn't touch you, don't utter it. But if you believe the prayer of Jabez and that God left it for you and for me so that we have a prayer that we can pray for the rest of our lives, and you know the power of this prayer, I want you to lift up your hand right now where you are. Wherever you are, lift up your hand, open it right up, because that's the state of your heart. You're open to God. I want you to pray the same prayer of Jabez after me. And you know, Jabez, he called out to God. Everybody say, called out to God. He called out to God, and you're calling out to God now as your Father. And now you say these words aloud in your heart and with your mouth after me. Say, oh Lord, bless me. Oh Lord, enlarge my tent. Oh Lord, let your hand be upon me. Oh Lord, keep me from evil. Oh Lord, that I may not cause pain. Say it one more time as a church now. I'm going to ask us to pray it corporately as a church. And those of you online, you pray the same prayer because you're part of Passover Church. Part of Passover, the Church of Skyline, or it's part of Passover, the greater Church of God, universal. You pray this prayer. And Jabez called upon the Lord and he said, oh Lord, bless us. Oh Lord, enlarge our territory. Oh Lord, let your hand be upon us. Oh Lord, keep us from evil. Oh Lord, that we may not cause pain. In Jesus' name. Let it sink into your hearts. Amen. And I challenge you, wherever you are today, where you're listening from, whether you've heard the prayer of Jabez before, just for the first time or whatever, God is speaking to you and is to me. Call upon God. Call upon His name. Call Him to bless you. But remember, intimacy and His glory is a starting point. Call upon Him to enlarge your territory. Amen. Call upon Him for His hand to be upon you, to keep you from evil, that you may not cause pain. And this is the promise of God. I want to speak to each and every one of us right now as you're listening. Just like God said to Jabez, and God granted his request. Amen. I pray that God will grant your request as you live the prayer of Jabez in your life. Now, for many of you, you may not know the source of this wonderful blessing. His name is Jesus. And if today you want to give your heart to Jesus because you say, Lord, I want to enter into this blessing. I've never given my heart to Jesus. Please don't go away right now. If that's you, if you may be listening online, here in the auditorium, will you pray this simple prayer with me? Because the entry into God's blessing comes when you open your heart to Jesus today. Because he died on the cross for your sins, took away your sins on the cross, so that you may come into God's presence as your Father. So you say, Pastor Philip, I want to receive Jesus. I want to open my heart to God. Pray this prayer with me right now where you are. Say, Father God, I thank you that Jesus died for me on the cross. Thank you that you are the God of blessing. Today, I open my heart and ask you to come into my life to be my Lord, my Savior, my Master. From this day, I am in the family of Jabez and I am blessed. And from this day, you are my God forevermore. In Jesus' name, amen. If you prayed that prayer, congratulations. Welcome to God's wonderful family. Don't go away because, you know, at the end of this time here, somebody will come out and just give you a link so that you can connect with this wonderful family called Skyline. I pray you've been blessed. Remember, you are the congregation of Jabez. Wherever you are part of this great family that prays the prayer of Jabez. God bless you. Have a great week. See you again soon. Amen. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Pastor Phil. Thank you, Pastor Phil. Okay, so if you prayed that prayer just now, you know, you prayed for Jesus to come into your life, we want to connect with you. This is a significant moment in your life. And what we can do is you can scan this QR code that's on the screen right now. You know, if you've made that decision, let us know about it. This is the best way that we can reach you, the best way we can walk with you through your new journey. So why don't you do that right now, whether you're online or you're on site, just scan the QR code and we're going to be there for you every single step of the way.